Now is the time for leadership. Because leadership doesn't give two hoots what your name is. Leadership doesn't give two hoots where you come from, what your heritage is, and what you're paid to do. Leadership is about stepping up to the plate and doing what has to be done at that moment. That's what leadership is. Unfortunately, my friend Jay isn't a leader. He's the guy next door. But he steps up to the plate and he takes the actions which bring me here today talking to you. He takes my ice pick, his ice pick, the harness. He has to leave because, sorry about those tires, when he anchors the and he uses the harness initially, he comes to the edge and he peers over and he sees the blood splattered body and he's dead. He believes at that stage dead, best friend, 50 metres down. Well, climbing ropes are 50 metres and one person can only use half of it, that's 25 metres. So, he leaves the harness, he leaves the rope, he takes two ice picks and the crampons. Crampons go onto your climbing boot. This is a typical climbing boot here. Put on your designer typical climbing boot. And you go chip, chip, chip. Climbing backwards down a ladder to a dead friend on your own in Antarctica. It's not like the 7-Eleven around the corner. He comes down there and he finds, I've got broken bones in my leg, crushed belt, pelvis, suspected broken back, every rib on my left hand side broken, fractured skull, bleeding from the ear and mouth, and pretty severe brain damage. Most of that's Jay's assessment with regard to brain damage. You already knew that. Jay went to school with me. For the next 3 days, Jay lays on me to give me his body temperature so I didn't die of hypothermia. At least that's his excuse. It was a boarding school. Boom, boom. See, humans always going to be boom, 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 boom. Got to wait for the pause. He climbs back up to the surface and he sets up the HF, high frequency radio. He makes the call the next night at 20:00, 8 p.m. to the yacht Toluca. The yacht Toluca is skippered by my friend, Roger. Roger answers and he goes, "Congratulations, guys, well done, you made history. We've got a chocolate cake and we've got champagne and ice." And Jay says, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, Pete's been taken by an avalanche, I think his back's broken and we need help." Leadership is an interesting thing. Leadership isn't so much what you do sometimes, is it? Sometimes it's about making a hard call, yeah? In hard situations, but a call that needs to be made. Sometimes leaders can make those calls because they can see what others can't. Rog, from the sea, could see up that the mountain was still avalanching. And Jay couldn't see that. And he said, "Jay-Z, get out of there. Get out of there now. It's one thing to lose one person, but we're not going to lose you and change three people up there and lose them as well." And Jay says, "Rog, I'm going down there this night. And I'm going to lay there that night with my friend. And if he's alive at 6 a.m. tomorrow morning, let's reconvene, let's have a scared, let's have a radio call, and let's put a plan into action." My friend comes down there and I live. Today's story to you is not that story. That is not my story. This story today is about my journey from there to here. Because the thing I want to talk to you today about, it's been described by many great philosophers and academics. I think the greatest philosopher described the best way was actually an Englishman, Austin Powers. And he called it your mojo. You with me? Your mojo. I lost it. I lost my mojo. It's like the whiteboard, the butcher's paper, I lost that as well. But I completely lost my mojo. I was looking around for it, like I was doing this, I was doing that, I was doing jobs I hated, I was saying language that wasn't me, I was living a lie. I'm looking for my mojo. Where the hell's my mojo gone? All I know is that people who loved me greatly knew that I wasn't quite there. I wasn't quite living the truth. You with me? You know anybody that does that? Does something they can justify, like I justified the avalanche. It wasn't my fault, it was our Lord's fault, yeah? Not living the truth. Because if I look at the life that I've got now, the beautiful wife and three gorgeous children, obviously they follow their mother with regard to looks. You know, I travel around the world as a speaker. That's what I do. I love entertaining. Hopefully I've got a point to my story. I run tours to Antarctica, I run leadership programs in Australia. I have my sport, I play polo, and I'm a leader at my local cub group, and I'm always going bowling and abseiling with the kiddies. I'm just a big kid. But the fact is, I wasn't. I was living the biggest lie you've ever heard of. Because when Jay hauls me out of that ice, he brings me out of the ice. He brings me back onto the surface of reality, this world. But you know what? I didn't want to live what I'd just been given. How's the irony in that? I come back in here, you wouldn't believe it. Now I can justify it, and I'll give you my justification right now. I'm sorry if I'm emphasizing the word justification, but you know what? I think I'm on my own. Eh? Anybody done anything ever in their life which they've justified? Come on. I've got ice picks down here. Anybody done anything that they've justified? Come on. Yes. Hello. Thank you for sharing. Dr. Phil. Because I was justifying this, I come back to Australia and I've got this thing called brain damage. Brain damage. You see, this is not. Hopefully. I was taken on a medical sleep.
I've been seeing, I'm not sure if it's therapies.
Actually, here I've been taught the range of therapies in between, about a month.
Trying to learn how to speak together.
They had to talk about cognitive issues. How to know the name. You see, the classic there is the E is still upside down. I had a front left hand vocal damage, which is communication, which was suffer of MS, multiple sclerosis, taught me this years ago. She said, Peter, acceptance is the toughest pill you'll ever swallow. You with me? We prescribe pills, yeah? Acceptance, the toughest one you'll ever swallow. What I'm about now, hence the topic of today's talk, is not prescribing pills, but giving a recipe for results. And the recipe for results I've got for you to advocate to others to live the truth, because I wasn't. Here's what I did. You see, I could justify what I did. I had guilt, and I had debt. I had some guilt, and I had some debt, right? What did I have? Guilt and?
Debt.
And then I had a little bit more debt. And then I had a little bit more. And then I had some more debt. And a little more guilt. You know what I decided to do? I thought I might think about it a bit. It's really good fun thinking about debt and guilt. You ever done that? You ever spent your whole weekend just thinking about the credit card statement you got on the Saturday morning mail? You ever done that? It's great. Don't you have a great weekend when you do that? Isn't it just awesome? You know, I did it for a year. All I could think about was debt and guilt. And so I justified what I went and did. And what I went and did is I started flogging moisturizers, hair care products with a network marketing company. And how much did I love it? Not much. I hated it. Right? So I'm doing this, but I'm doing it hard. But boy, I could justify it. So here I am. I can hardly keep up with my daughter who's getting older now. She's now coming up 2 years, 2 years old. She's running around the kitchen table and I can't keep up with her because my hip, I've got a condition called avascular necrosis. My femur died because of the sever from the blood flow. My femur was out through my bottom for 6 days. And so as a result of that, I lost all the blood flow to it. I got avascular necrosis. Well, my daughter's running around the kitchen table. I'm quite competitive. I couldn't keep up with her. So I call up my surgeon. I say, listen, doc, give me a new hip. He says, you're too young. The doc, give me a new hip. He gives me a new hip. I keep flogging these moisturizers. I'm hating it. And hair care products.